Hi, and welcome everybody to an open conversation with the Netflix sound team. I'd like to welcome you all and just remind you that we will be recording this event. Just a little bit about the show. We are on Zooms, so we'd just like to give you a little few housekeeping tips to make the most of this. And also we have a Q&A box, which we encourage you to use. And you can type in questions in Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, if you're that way inclined. We have Sashi, one of my colleagues with us, who will help tackle those and answer and present them to us as well, because we just thought that it might be, there's no need to feel shy. You can stay anonymous if you want, or you can put your name. We're just going to have fun today. This is for you guys, and welcome once again. I'd like you to introduce you to Scott and Ozzy, the people who are going to speak. And my name's Nakul Kamte. In case you don't know me, I see a lot of familiar faces. Hello, everyone. For those who don't know me, I started as a recording engineer way back donkey's years ago. Went on to do location sound, sound design. I am the culprit for the term sound design, because I used it as my credit in the first two films I did as a tribute to Walter Murch, and it stuck in the Indian industry. My role at Netflix is as a sound specialist, and what I'm here for is really to help all of you if you ever have any issues. We aim at Netflix to give our members the best audio experience possible, and for that, I think we need to have your help as well, because it's you guys who are doing the work. We are just here to guide you. So anytime you have any issues or any questions, please do not hesitate to reach out. We have chosen these two settings because I think there's, having spoken to a few of you, there's been some confusion of what an M&E track is. It's not a music stem. It's not a dialogue stem. Scott will take you through that in more detail when he starts. Ozzy is going to do loudness measurements and things. And the reason why I wanted to have this is because at Netflix, when your stuff is on Netflix, it's going to be, your stuff is going to be seen at the same time as maybe someone watching The Irishman. So keeping that in mind, there are certain things which we suggest you do, and that's what this webinar is about. This is the first of many, I hope. We will cover different things. In fact, at the end of this, if you could, if there's anything in particular you guys want to do, whether it's dialogue editing, dialogue cleanups, location sound, hints and tips and tricks, we can do all of those. There is a difference between OTT and theatrical, and while I realize that most of you have worked on theatrical, OTT brings along with it a completely different need for how to do it so that it's in a living room. The difference between theatrical and OTT for the main part is that we do not, the last thing you want is people reaching for a remote, because that will take you out of what you're watching. We don't want to do that to the viewer. Just once again, a reminder that you can type in questions in whichever language you want, English, Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, if you want to, and we will help you and be happy to answer any of those. So without wasting any more time, I'd like to introduce you to Scott Kramer, who's my boss and very cool guy. And over to you, Scott.
Thanks, Nicole. Hi, everyone. I'm the manager for sound technology at Netflix. We're building a global sound team to help support you and make sure the quality of Netflix content is as good as it can be. I also look after international standards and delivery specifications to the studio. And being, you know, in California, closer to the headquarters, I'm really interested in ways to push the experience for our members around the world through sound. So I'm here to talk about M&E. I think that it's something I was taught almost 20 years ago now, and I really enjoyed making them for a time, although it's a little bit counterintuitive to do an M&E as opposed to a regular mix. But once you finish the regular mix, your full mix, you have these stems, you have all of your edited units, and those units are actually fully mixed. So you've got all the automation and all the original editorial tracks and your stems. And with a kind of collection of these various items, we can make an M&E, and we'll do it with varying degrees of complexity. So I am going to show you a screen here. That is an M&E mix session. So this is my M&E session, and I've got at the top, I have a dialogue stem. It's a 6-channel dialogue stem. I've got a room to place optional materials for the M&E. I have PFX pulled directly from dialogue units, a music stem, a background stem, which is, these are 5 channels, and then effect stem. And then we have Foley units. So this is kind of a quicker M&E. The first thing you would do to make it even better would be to add all of your original dialogue mixed units. So you'd have all the automation of EQ and all of the processing you apply to the dialogue and any dialogue, you know, master busing in the session as opposed to this stem. But in many cases in my career, I found that just working from this stem was enough, particularly if you weren't using a lot from the original track besides primary language. So as we go through this, we've got this section here, and I'm going to play through and show you some of the decisions I would make here. So in the first pass, what we're looking to do is edit the dialogue completely to remove any original language dialogue and then keep everything that's ancillary, because that adds to making it a really great M&E. So in this case, we have a principal character, and he's being drug into a not a great situation for this guy, but we have these great efforts, and to have a dub actor do this would maybe not be ideal. This is a good performance, so we want to keep it. The reason we can keep it is I don't hear chest voice. I don't hear a voice from him that is identifiable as that actor. This is something that in theory could have been performed by many different people. And so it could be compatible with the dub actor, because we're going to get a great voice to dub his lines. But this could be the dub actor, because I don't hear the chest voice there. So we're going to keep that. And I'm going to put an edit just to kind of protect that. Let's see what's next. So I don't really, I mean, I hear that great effort, but I also hear some group ADR from the kind of zombies, and I don't think we can keep that. I'm going to throw this bit on the optional track because this looks like a, I can see a reverb tail there, and I can tell this is kind of a nice moment that would be good to maybe include depending on what the dub studio wants to do. But all this stuff, I hear that group ADR in there. So unfortunately we have to lose that and the dub actor will recreate the efforts. So here we got something we can't keep. He's saying, come on, come on. We're gonna lose that. And then we have some stuff we can keep, which is that effort.
The hell.
And so I'm gonna put some fades there, so transition it in and out, and then keep that effort stuff.
The hell with this.
He's not really happy about the situation. I'm gonna lose this bit. And then I think we have some more effort. There's a bit of chest voice there, and because it's connected to that effort, that would be okay. I think they're not going to want it to be a bunch of holes in the middle of this track, so we're going to keep the kind of longer sections of efforts, but we're going to lose that effort just after the chest voice bit because dub actor might not like to just have to do that one moment and it may not match very well. So we're going to lose that. So then we have a lot more dialogue and efforts and kind of more of the same. I wanted to show you this other moment where we got, this thing. So, so it's effort, it's chains, it's a P effect from production that stayed in the movie, but it's on top of effort. We can't keep that. We need the dub actor to do that one. But we can keep some of the chain stuff. That sounds pretty clean. And there's an auto fade on there. So I'm going to go down to Foley. And I ran over to another section and I found some chains right here for him, for Luke. And I have these. They're not exactly the same, but you know, with an M&E, the sounds that you add should be as close as they can be to the original, but we understand that they can't be the exact same sounds. So this is okay. So this is real low. I'm gonna clip gain it up a bit. Let's listen to it. Unmute the stem. All right, so we got the moment is covered. We have the chains there on his effort. I would probably shape those more, and you know what I've learned is I can shape them just with a fade. Even do a bit of an edit here to get those in place. Maybe gain it up a little more because it was a kind of a big thing. Okay, so. If it were me, I would go into my sound effects library and find something better for that, that then works with what comes after it and it sounds, you know, just more realistic to what we heard in the original. But it's an example of what you can pull in for that. And in addition to that, any Foley that I've lost, other than things like the big things, like the chains, footsteps, you know, cloth movement, all that, I have to make sure it's in and loud enough and it's filling in the gaps where I've lost that meat, because the dialogue, we always play it loud enough that any P effects that are on there, any Foley, anything that happens on the set that the microphone picked up, that's also gonna be prominent. So we have to make sure the Foley's in there to cover that. So this is all stuff that you can do before you're doing your M&E mix. And I found that these make the M&Es better. And we want the M&Es to be as good as we can, because it's very possible that more people outside of India will see your work than inside. And our titles are meant to travel and play internationally for a huge global audience. So we want the track that the dubbing studios use to be as good as possible. And you know, you'll have a link later to an in-depth video on all this. I'm just going to show you one quick thing before we move on, which is, you know, the M&E mix. Once you've prepared this well, the optionals are not going to be bussed out to your speakers, but they're going to be bussed to special optional tracks. Once you've prepared it very well, the mix becomes just really a matter of writing these dialogue moments and transitioning out of production dialogue and getting back into it when you have, you know, are able to use it, and then making sure the Foley is prominent. But in general, you shouldn't have to go into anything else. Music, backgrounds, effects, if you don't have specific identifiable primary language in the backgrounds, you don't need to do any edits there or do any changes. And so these can just go straight across. You're really mixing what's left of the production against Foley and making it feel cohesive and like making it feel like one experience. I don't want to hear holes in this track. And so it becomes really about mixing that dialogue and making sure that we're going smoothly. It's a big Foley thing there. So we're going to need to go find something for that hand movement. So we have to make sure that all those moments are filled. I can see that there was some kind of edit done in a conform here. So I'm going to have to do some cuts and make sure that that's in there. You know, that was pretty clean. I can just kind of go right back into that. I could really hear that drop and transition to Foley. So I want to kind of ease out of that a little more. It was a little better. The Foley kind of picked up for it and I didn't have as much of a hole there. Right. You know, there's a lot going on in the music here, and that really couches everything. It gives you some room to move, so it doesn't have to be perfect. When you're in a situation where you've got no music, no loud backgrounds, nothing to kind of cover you, this work you're doing with what backgrounds you have against the rest of the track is really crucial. And sometimes adding extra center channel backgrounds will help cover for things, because you're one thing that you're losing, especially if the production sound is not great, is you're losing that sound of the space, whether it's a noisy room, an apartment, or where the performance is happening, or you're outside and you're hearing a lot of noise. You've cleaned it up as much as you could in the main mix, but it's still, there's a little bit of it in the track. When you cut through all this dialogue, you're causing those dropouts. And so the name of the game for this process is really about filling the center channel track and making it feel cohesive with backgrounds and Foley. Backgrounds become a real big part of it when there's broadband noise on the track. I'm going to turn it back over to Nicole because it looks like I've used a lot of my time here, but we have a video that Ozzy's going to show a link to, and we'll make sure everybody gets that. It's a more in-depth view of making an M&E. And I think it'll be very helpful. You can also reach out to us, Nicole, anytime you want for more questions. And I'd be happy to set up some of these for smaller groups of people to just go over some of the details here. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen. And thanks very much for your time. And I'm going to turn it over to Nicole.
Thank you, Scott. That was wonderful. I do hope that has helped a lot of you with what it is. Don't worry about it. We will be sending you all links to where the YouTube video is. I would now like to introduce to you he's a hell of a guy, Ozzy Sutherland, who's going to take you through Loudness, and he's an extremely hip and cool guy.
Thank you, Nakul. You're way cooler than me. Way cooler. Nakul's the man. So I'm going to take you guys through some loudness things here at Netflix and just very candid, just talking about these things. But I put the alphabet up just to see if everyone's still here and awake with me, just because I can. But I just wanted to touch quickly on high quality audio. The term is used quite a bit here at Netflix. You'll hear Nakul say it, you'll hear Scott talk about it. But what is high quality audio to us here at Netflix? You know, what that means is we want it captured on the day, you know, by the most highly qualified mixers and boom operators, you know, just following industry-wide practices, best practices. We want people to mix in a suggested Netflix size stage. This doesn't mean that the stage has to be this size, but we kind of see, you know, good sizes being 30 feet by 40 feet by 15 feet high, or 9 meters by 12 meters by 4 meters. That doesn't mean to go just build your stage exactly like that. It depends upon your work and everything that's coming in there. But a suggested Netflix size stage would be kind of like a large living room, if you will. We like people to try to pre-mix as much as you can in sound editorial. That then eases and gives more time for them to craft the soundscape and give the mixers more time on stage to really get creative with everything as much as possible. Everything at Netflix is 5.1 and 2.0 minimum delivered for audio on all titles. So that's the 5.1 and 2.0 minimum for every single audio track on all titles. Immersive audio whenever possible, meaning Dolby Atmos as the top level audio master. And you can obviously trim your passes for the lower tonal formats from Atmos. And this is my quote, and it's a running joke and quote within the team. Remember that audio is 51% of the experience, according to me, Triple Platinum, aka Ozzy. That's my nickname on the team. And we have a running joke with our imaging team where 51% is the audio experience. It's a little more than the visual experience, if you will. So just always trying to give audio some credit. So what I'm going to talk about now is the dialogue problem. You know, the number one customer complaint is that you can't hear the dialogue. And that's not something we want to hear at Netflix. So, you know, a customer would normally set their level according to what they hear, you know, coming off of their television or whatever device they're using to listen to Netflix. So they set it and as they desire it to hear it. So the previous spec set the level according to the overall full mix, which wasn't great. So the results from that was inconsistent dialogue levels across the entire service, inconsistent for episodes within a series, inconsistent from title to title, meaning, you know, from a film to a documentary to anything, it was inconsistent. So you can see here on this little chart, full program loudness even varies between a series. So you see like the first one there is episode 5's loudness is at minus 30. Then by the time you get to episode 10, it's actually at minus 26, which is showing that there's different dynamics happening across the show. So in 2018, we switched to dialogue gated measurement. So the solution around this was dialogue intelligence, basically. And what is dialogue gated measurement is probably the question everyone always asks the most from whenever we do any of these type of things. So basically a viewer adjusts the television and sets their volume controls so they can hear the dialogue intelligently and audibly. Most content creators typically set dialogue at a fixed level and then you mix everything else around it. And then, you know, the main thing about dialogue gated measurement is that it's measuring loudness only on the segments of a program that contain dialogue. So what that allows is consistent dialogue levels across the entire service, across everything. And this is easier for all of you out there working on these sound crews. For your room reference level stays the same for every title. No post-mix loudness correction is needed for this. So it means you don't have to go in and normalize or do any kind of crazy things to it. And it allows for us to do some great things on the back end too, where Scott mentioned before, he's working to set the global standards as much as possible. So he's working closely with the EBU and ITU to have consideration for this even more out there. And then the ultimate thing that we all like to say is that we want everyone's remote to stay on the table or couch or wherever they want to keep it, so they don't have to be riding the volume to understand what their favorite character or the actor is saying on the show. So there's a bunch of meters that support dialogue gated measurement and DAW-based meters. So whatever DAW you love, whether it's Pro Tools, Nuendo, Resolve, whatever is out there that you choose to use as your axe, you have NuGen, Isotope, Signum, and Waves are some DAW-based versions of that. And then there's, on an enterprise level, if you're from an enterprise facility, you'll have something like Emotion Systems EFF or Intera Systems Baton that you might use. And I just have a couple slides here with some pictures of this. Here is NuGen Visual M, which is one of the most popular ones that is out there. The other one here is Isotope Insight, Waves WLM, Signum Butte, and that's kind of like your standards that are out there right now that you would see a lot of these used for doing dialogue gated measurement and such. And plus, some of them have Netflix presets inside of them also. So something I want to touch on is mixing for broadcast and streaming, and how this it's very important to understand. The background picture you see on this slide is actually one of the biggest dub stages in the world. That's the Cary Grant Theater here in Los Angeles at Sony Pictures. So that's a cinema Atmos mixing style room. You know, it's a very, very big room. So in normal cinema mixing, your reference level is 85 dB, obviously, because you're mixing for a big theater. TV reference levels should be 79 dB and 82 dB maximum that your reference level of the room is. That being, you know, you want to make sure that you're mixing in a comfortable way, and you're mixing for the audience that you're going to present your work to. So an important thing is to be able to check the versions that you're working on. You know, make sure you're checking if you're doing it in Atmos and you're checking the 5.1 down mix, or you're checking stereo quality of that, making sure that you're ensuring that as it goes through the process. And then, you know, the other thing is too, that you're also thinking about that you're mixing for mobile at the same time too. A lot of people consume Netflix and other things on their mobile device. And I'm sure you see that in India quite a bit. So one of the big things here is that, you know, we try to make sure that the peaks don't exceed minus 2 dBFS. A really good trick that I didn't put a slide in here for, but something I want to tell you all is that, you know, if you use, say, like the Avid Pro Limiter, for instance, and then there's a Netflix peak limiting preset in there, you can actually just have it set, and it's a minus 2.3, and it's a nice thing to put on your buses or put on your Atmos objects or however you're mixing, or whatever you're doing, but just a nice little blanket to put there to make sure things don't go past or peak, and you've set that there. But, you know, loudness metering is a big thing that we get a lot of questions about. So Netflix, we do minus 27 LKFS dialogue gated. And as you see here, when you're measuring loudness, if you have something that's like measured at a 4, it's not dynamic. When it's at 20, it's very dynamic. And 23 is cinema level. So putting this out there, if you mix something that is cinema reference or cinema level, and it's only going to play on Netflix for a global audience, that is not going to play very well from a loudness standpoint for our viewers to enjoy. They will have issues with the dynamic range of that show. So you want to stay, you don't want to not be too dynamic, not dynamic enough, but you also want to be in that green zone or less to keep it very dynamic, keeping to the creative intent of what you and the director, showrunners have in mind for this show or title that you're working on. And just make sure it's consistent for the global audience that's out there. We can touch on this a bit more in the Q&A with all of us in a bit. Another thing, we will share this with you after, is our sound specifications. If you go to help.prodigal.com, you don't have to go there right now, but that's where all the post-production technical specs are, and that's a link within this that you can go to at any time and learn about all of our technical specs from sound to even cameras. So there's a Netflix sound mix specifications and best practices document there, version 1.2. And some of the key things in there is that we give the core specifications, X-curve guidance, making sure to, you know, have matching camera and editorial frame rates, you know, your loudness to 18 loudness units, 916 optimal and 714 is required if you're mixing any Dolby Atmos content. 714 is a minimum requirement for a room that you're mixing Atmos content for Netflix in. 916 is optimal, and we put that in there because from what we've found, and Scott and I have 916 rooms here in Los Angeles that we use in our sound rooms that are here in Los Angeles. And we find just having that extra left wide and right wide make for a better experience when you're listening to content, just widens it a bit too. But 714 minimum. And Netflix Home Atmos Deliverable Requirements version 2.1 is another document that you can see. So there's certain little things that happen there, you know, removing the stem requirement. The M&E was allowed to be delivered as a Pro Tools recorder session. We also recommend working with Dolby on any DART and speaker calibrations, but Dolby Atmos certification is not required for Home Atmos mix rooms or for anyone working on Netflix content out there. So we know it's important that you work with Dolby on the DART and the speaker calibration, but do remember you don't have to be Dolby Atmos certified to work on content for Netflix. I'm going to touch on M&E really quick again. I know Scott took you through a nice demo there, and I was actually giggling inside when, you know, I was listening to some of those efforts and everything else, because it's just what we do. And it's sometimes laughable, but sometimes a lot of fun. So the music effects and localization, Global Studios dub in up to 40 different languages. There's no secondary audio when it's a dub. Many viewers actually prefer the dubs in their local language, so it's much easier for them to watch it. And then the biggest point to this, and getting back to what Scott was showing before, is, you know, you want to budget time, editorial time that can help the M&E so that it can speed up the process and speed up the efficiencies. And you really want to set aside time to make sure you check them, because remember, these are your it's like your gateway to the global audience with the M&E. So you have and this M&E is created by you, and now that has to set the global stage for the Spanish dub, the French dub, the English dub even. So you wanna make sure that you budget the time to make sure it's correct. And you also set aside the time to check it before it goes and make sure it's what you wanted and what you intended with the director for that show, that title. So again, this is just a reiteration of the music and effects mix, and the creation guidelines is a link there that you can head to. So it's basically the dialogue stem, flip stem, console, M&E, and filled effects stem at the end of this journey. And then this is a link that you all will get to a video that's available on YouTube that Scott created on, it's a Netflix music and effects creation tutorial. It's a nice 30-minute tutorial that you can go and watch, and it takes you through, Scott will take you through every step of creating a great M&E. So with that, you know, myself, Scott, Nakul, we all feel the future is very, very bright with all the great content that can come out of India, and with all of you out there working on this content and making it sound the best it can, and pushing sound forward as much as you want, and we're here to help you. And the future is very bright for Indian content on Netflix. I'm into some of the series and everything like that too from out of India, and it's fun. It's fun to be able to watch content from other regions and get into it, and you just never know how awesome it would be. So it's great to see the global stage and to see India on that stage also, that we can consume content that's amazing from the region. And again, this is the key. Please don't be afraid to reach out to us. We're not going to crush you like a Coke can or anything. We're not going to get angry. We're going to be very cool. We love talking to everyone in the community. We love having this banter back and forth. Nakul is your main man over there in India. And Scott and I are here in Los Angeles. And as he said, we're growing a global team. So we are here for you. So don't ever be afraid to reach out to us. And now we're going to have a open Q&A session. And please don't hesitate to ask any questions. We are here to answer your questions. And so everybody's going to come back on camera now.
Thank you for that, Oz. That was wonderful. I'm going to take the first question. Mixing for Dolby-based cinema halls in OTT is different. What are the major things? Well, Karuna, I think the main thing is the dynamic range between the two of them, because the way I'd like to put it in a really basic sense is theater is in a film theater, OTT is in a bedroom. So the primary thing is to engage the audience is, to me, the worst thing, what throws me off completely is when I have to reach for a remote and play with the levels to deal with loud songs or action sequences. Even the levels are different. We suggest for OTT 79 to 82, whereas for cinema, it's 85. And that's 3 dB, which is like double the volume. So I hope that helps answer your question.
Nicole, I would just add to that too. It's like, you know, louder doesn't always mean better all the time. You know, that's like, I think a big thing about it too. It's like you feel like you need in a film mixing environment, all of us have been there on dub stages, you know, Scott, you, myself included, and you get the chest, you feel the big explosion and everything like that. You can still feel that in the mix for, you know, at 79 dB or whatever you're doing. It's just dynamically, you can't go as hard. And there's not that level of SPL in a room. Like this room I'm in here is not gonna feel that SPL the way you would at home. Like I'm in my home and I would feel it much differently. So you gotta think about who's gonna be consuming the content and how they're gonna be consuming it. So I think it's important to know that louder doesn't always mean it's the best. It's especially in sound.
Yeah, I think also to add to what you're saying, Ozzy, it's just a narrower dynamic bandwidth which you need to play with in OTT. And it's not such a bad thing. And you can go loud. I mean, explosions and things will be louder. No issues with that. What Ozzy was talking about with loudness meters, hopefully that has helped you guys. You can have certain parts which are louder. Not an issue. It's just, I would suggest to me for OTT, the first thing you do is set up your dialogue at a level and then mix up against that. Do you agree, Ozzy? Scott? It's a different way of looking at it, but what I'm trying to say is dialogue is key.
Dialogue is, for our viewers on Netflix, dialogue is the number one complaint. Like we said before, if they can't hear the dialogue, they're going to be upset. They will complain. Then they do complain if they can't hear the dialogue on a show. So that's why it's important. So dialogue is definitely the king.
Moving to the second question, is Dolby certified studio required to mix and create content for Netflix? Also, I think there was a question about size of room. I think we don't really care about, what we're bothered about is, does it translate well? If that happens, we're pretty much okay with you guys doing whatever you want. It is a huge cost to get Dolby certification and things. But at the same time, I would leave that. I'd like to bring Scott into this at this point of time.
Sorry, I was answering questions in the chat. What's the question?
Dolby certified studio.
Right. I mean, we want the audio to be great quality, and whatever gets you there is great. We don't feel that artists can do their best work when they're in a poor environment. At the same time, there are some Dolby requirements that are unnecessary. And we're not the ones to decide what is necessary and what isn't. We leave that to mixers. But everyone should understand that we're watching every single title. we're keenly aware of the audio quality. And we expect the very best. And it's not our place to require particular equipment to achieve that. It's really about the artistic skill of the mixer.
Excellent. I see so much content from India failing in terms of audio. How can we unite each and every engineer and guide them for the betterment of the content? Scott, you want to take that since you'll give a different perspective?
That content is failing for India?
Yeah. I see so much content from India failing in terms of audio. How can we unite each and every engineer, and guide them for the betterment of
content? That's a Nicole question. That's your job now.
I think it's a Nicole is going to lead you're going to lead the way to help guide everyone.
We've got to start changing things where we are, this is the main thing, is that it's different from theatrical and OTT is different. I'm here to help all of you. Theatrical is most of your background. This is a completely new thing. It is going to take a little time to change. That's what I'm here for, to help you do that. If you follow the loudness meters and use your ears and common sense, I don't think it's going to be such a big deal, because I think you guys are immensely talented. And we just need to show that to the rest of the world how good it is here. So, yeah, that's what my thing would be.
And always know that you have us here too. We're here to help. I mean,
we'll be there.
Nicole's there, and you have Scott and I here too.
How do I strike the balance between trusting my ear and the level on the meter in case either one feels right? Well, the level on the meter is more accurate till your ear gets used to that. So I would say you need to listen, look at the meter, and then based on what the meter says, use your ears. Because it's a balance between the two, really, isn't it? Your ears are, at the end of the day, your ears are the king. But the meters are what gives you where you should be in the ballpark figure of where you should be. Because if you're not in the meter level, you're going to get rejected by QC, and it's going to come back, and it's, you might get upset about it, but there's a reason why we have those levels. Ozzy, do you want to take that on the reason why we have those levels, because of the bandwidth and everything?
Yeah, I mean, repeat that question again, the first part of that question.
Oops, I just did a done on it. Do you have it still?
I think I might have it. It was...
Using ears versus meters.
Oh, using your ears versus the meters. Yeah. So one thing I was going to say to that, because I was listening to you talk about that there just now, is I think one of the things that anyone should do is just... as much as you have the time to do it, is watch a lot of content if you can, and just listen to content and listen to your own content and listen to other content. And And then I think your ears will also adjust just hearing those, the consistency and content and stuff like that too. Using the meters, yes, the meters are accurate. They're very accurate, especially, you know, some of those meters that are out there, and they're relied upon daily on a stage. But at the end of the day, we still trust the mixer's ears and their intelligence to make that right and get that to the point that they feel is the way it should sound, no matter what. But by using the meters, you're just technically seeing where it needs to land to play well and fit well into the library and play with the content correctly. So at the end of the day, I think it's still creative. You still want your creative tact to be the most important thing, that you creatively feel that's right. And maybe you're creatively doing it and it might be a little louder, but then you look at the meter and you say, ah, you know what? I can pull that back a little bit. It's still going to play well that way. So that's kind of how I feel that approach should be. But it's also, you know, important to make sure you stay within the spec, because if when you're even after you're done with the project and now it goes to QC, you don't want to have QC issues on a show with, you know, your measurements being out of spec and things like that for your dialogue gated measurement for those, if you're not using the meters properly.
When I was learning, I would do a mix and then I would look at the meter at the end and realize I had to move a bunch of levels to be in spec. So as I learned, and as you get used to it, you'll automatically be making mixes that are in spec, because the way it sounds to you will be the way that's in spec. And then it's just important to check and have that feedback. I think Nicole and Ozzy would agree, a great mix is like a great song. It never feels like there's an empty moment. It always feels good. And it's really about emotions. I had a boss who would say, what are you doing on the computer? And is it affecting what's coming out of the speakers? Because all that matters is how it sounds and how it looks. And sometimes I would be too obsessed with looking at the screen and the objects and things going by, and I wouldn't be watching the picture, watching the film and thinking about it and feeling and translating that feeling into sound. So that's really what we're after here. And the meter is just a verification that you're in spec. You're muted, Nicole.
How do you tackle the issue of measuring loudness when a particular screen is heavy with effects and is very loud, but maybe the next scene is quiet? Again, Scott, will you take this?
Sure. It can be difficult in a battle. We've had some battle films where there's big war for half of the movie and there's a lot of yelling. That drags up the dialogue loudness level. And so then it changes the spec. We've also had musicals where the vocal is mistaken by the dialogue meter for dialogue, and then that drags up the average loudness. So then the mix sounds great, but you're ending up out of spec. If you have something that you really feel is an exception to the rule, call Nicole and we'll talk about it and we'll see if we need to make an exception, because there's always has to be room for nuance and understanding that it's art and everything that we're doing is different. And in some cases, the spec doesn't work. I will say that in the vast majority of cases, it does. Another prominent exception is when we put a concert film up on Netflix that doesn't work with dialogue measurement. So we do full program measurement. So I'd say there are some cases where the spec falls short, but I think it's very rare. It tends to be like musicals and big battle films and things like that. Plenty of action films, the spec still works perfectly fine. But if it's half action sequence or half musical numbers, then you can run into problems.
Yeah, I think you just have to be careful of those things. And I would use frequency to spread that out to help. Low, use the LFE, use low mids. It does just completely rebalance the thing. Shall we use our ears or the meter for the final mixed judgment or both? Well, again, we've been talking about this. I think you need to use both. At Netflix, we don't want to step on your creativity. That's what we really want. But it's got to be creativity within certain specs, which are there for a reason, which is that it's playing in someone's living room or bedroom. My clients usually ask me why OTT providers ask us to reduce the levels. How can I make them understand? It's a big problem while wanting good dynamics in the mix. I think Ozzy did speak about dynamics a little bit earlier on. Okay. And sorry, go on, Scott.
No, go ahead, Nicole.
No, I since you had spoken about it, do you want to just take that just so that it's reinforced?
It's just like Scott said, you know, it depends on the content. It depends on the title. But if it's too dynamic, it's going to be difficult to play well on Netflix and be streaming, because you're not sending that to a cinema. It's not going to a cinema. It's going to possibly my phone. It's probably going to my iPad. It might be going to the Sony or LG TV that I have at home, you know, and you have to remember your audience that it's playing for and provide them the best experience possible. While it's probably something in creative intent that you want it to be, you know, big and bombastic and super dynamic, I think that's where it comes in for you all to have the creativity still pull that dynamics off, but still, like Nicole was saying, make sure you stay within spec just so it can play well for everyone. And we're not trying to take away anything. We want you to be as creative as possible. We want you to push the boundaries of what you're doing and be creative and do the right thing for the director and showrunner. But we just want you to understand, like, your audience is very broad. It's a very big audience out there, and they are consuming this on many different styles of devices, and you want it to play well for them on all.
I'd just like to add, I think the biggest bad thing for me when watching television is using the remote. And that's what this is going to lead to if it is extremely a wide dynamic range, which is what I think Ozzy spoke about earlier in his presentation too. We will be giving this presentation. It will be sent to all of you. The deck which Ozzy was using, so that a lot of the answers I think are on that, which you might have missed while he was talking. We've also got about 3 minutes left. Okay. Comparing Sacred Grimms from India and Stranger Things from outside, there's a huge difference in audio in terms of quality, mixing, different experiences altogether. Why do we lack in technology? No, I don't think we lack in technology at all. We're using exactly the same things that they are in when they did Stranger Things. This is what this whole call is about. It's about trying to bridge the gap and try to get us on the same level of what they're doing. And I think the thing is that if you start heeding, this is why we're here, to help you achieve that. That's what my goal is, really, is to make sure that, like, people say Sacred Games season 3 sounds as bloody good as Stranger Things, you know. And which is why I've been saying, like, we need your help, and we're here to help you with that. And anything, if either of you want to add to anything while I'm just going through the questions, you're more than welcome.
Sure, yeah, I saw one about softer ambience levels taking a beating on mobile devices. You know, in most cases, the mobile devices are going to take care of this problem. And if they're not right now, they will be soon. Netflix just launched a new codec, XHEAAC, which includes automatic level correction. So there's a target level, probably, a little bit louder than what we our core spec. And it's going to boost the low stuff and reduce some of the loud stuff, but only for mobile devices where we know that members have a lot of trouble understanding the subtle mixes at all. So in many cases, we don't have to think about mobile when we're mixing. We can just make a great mix with a moderate dynamic range that will sound great in the living room and have confidence that it'll work on mobile devices.
I'm probably the last question since we're out of time. I don't know if we can take any more. The confusion factor is they have many OTT devices like Amazon, Z, Hotstar. Eventually engineers get confused and start comparing it. If I can do this level, why ask for some complicated specs? Why can't we have it? Well, to be quite honest, I think Netflix spends a lot of time in research and development on this, which is why we have these specs. I think everyone kind of trails a bit in that respect, but since this is it's a thing which you have to get used to. This is a new platform. This is a new way of living after COVID. I think this is only going to get, there's only going to be more work for us to do on various platforms. And once you get the basics of it, it's not really that much. It's not that different. I think is the best way of answering that. Jen, do we have time or what do we do since there are a lot? We will answer these questions, whatever we haven't got to.
If you'd like, we definitely have a few more minutes. So we allocated 90 minutes in total. So if you want to get through some more questions, I'll leave that up to you and the team.
All right. Okay. Debo, doing a mix looking at the meter, I think, is injustice to the creativity of a mix engineer. But you can't really mix a content looking at the meter. Because I always prefer the aesthetics than the technology. So what do you think?
I think this goes back to what Scott originally said, and both of us kind of said in the beginning, you know, like, it's really just there to give you...
Do your mix and just play with it that way.
Yeah.
Scott, do you want to elaborate a little bit more on, Ozzy, on... I'm saying that the key thing is the dialogue. That's the biggest complaint, if people cannot hear the dialogue. Secondly, I think in theatrical, our music is, it's not background, it's foreground music. In a bedroom, that doesn't work. You need to, as Ozzy said and Scott said, why don't you consider listening to different shows? And I know most of you have. And then you ask me, why is that different and why is this different? If you train your ears to listen to what's happening there and train your ears to what is happening here, there is a huge difference. And that's what needs to be bridged so that our stuff is more accessible to everyone and it sounds a lot better.
This is a problem everywhere. Not India. And I remember early in my career being on a mixing stage and the mixer said, we're going to mix this TV show like a feature. And they thought that was great. And I was cringing inside because I knew it wouldn't sound very good when it was broadcast. And it was I'm not going to name names, but it was a huge show that is known internationally. And it wasn't as good as it could have been because it was too close to a feature sound and it was all over the place and people had to, you know, have an uncomfortable experience riding the volume in the living room, especially on the little speakers that are in a lot of TVs. I think that we shouldn't downplay the artistic requirements of working in a broadcast environment. And strike a balance there. I mean, our spec allows so much freedom to make a cinema mix and still pass the spec, or to make a very narrow broadcast mix and pass the spec. I mean, a chat show or a football match is going to be very narrow dynamic range, and a feature film is very wide. And we're just asking to strike a balance there and be somewhere more moderate, because that's what people prefer. But we don't have a spec that ties people's hands and makes them work one way, because there are always exceptions to every rule. Just know that great art means considering the audience and who is going to be watching this, and how will it be consumed. And I have tremendous respect for all of my colleagues in the broadcast world who do great sensitive mixes for millions and millions of people at home. Far more impact.
Is it recommended to put noise in the center track to make the localized dub sound closer to the original? Yes, I would always take and cut room tone in from the original dialogue track, loop a little bit of that and place it under an ADR track, because otherwise it's going to be like a hole in the middle. So yes, you definitely do need to use a little bit of the noise from the center track.
In some cases, as you're flipping the dialogue stem where you're taking out the primary language, you can go and find fill from other places, and you actually are using the production track to fill in those holes. And in other cases, you need to grab a background and push the center channel, to Nicole's point, or find some room tone. If you're lucky enough to have room tone recordings from the set, this is great, because you can cut those in the center channel.
My sincere request toward Netflix to educate our director and producers, definitely not all. Also, because many a times it's so difficult to make them understand about the format, and after a point they start questioning about your talent. I'm here to help you with that. It's always been a battle, Devo. And yes, I mean, on a recent film, I think I asked the director I led him to the question, what is the most, the thing you hate most on watching television in your house? And he said, reaching for the remote. And I said, that's exactly what you're doing by asking it to be this crazy dynamic range, sir, and like a theatrical mix. And he understood that. So yes, it is, we do need to educate them, but it's, since they are, we don't want to step on their creative process either, but it takes, it is happening. It will be done slowly but surely.
And just to piggyback on that, Nicole, you know, Scott and I have done plenty of these same things here in the US for directors and showrunners, and had to do, you know, Atmos demos or things of that nature with them, and explain it to them and let them hear it and let them understand it a bit more. And it's something, I think, like you said, once they hear it and they understand, they get it. They'll get it, and they'll be more receptive. And through us being out there to talk to them, will help make your jobs easier, and in the long run too. We'll help you as much as possible.
I had a problem while watching Extraction. My hands were frequently on the remote. If it was mixed with reference to the specs, why did it happen? Is it the device issue or the mix? I would let Ozzy take this. Extraction interesting... was because it was action all the way through.
It was a lot of action all the way through, yes. And so, and it kind of comes back to what Scott was talking about. But interestingly, I'd be curious to know what device they used to watch that on. I watched it on two different devices here at home, and I didn't have an issue with Extraction. And I don't know if Scott, did you hear anything else on that?
Well,
with
I mean,
Extraction?
I think it was a great mix, but
yeah,
I think it was very dynamic, and I think it's important to spotlight that, you know, we're spending so much time talking about loudness and dynamic range. We don't enforce dynamic range. We enforce the loudness and the peak spec. So making sure you're hitting that number for loudness is enforced, but you can achieve that just by turning the whole mix up and down, and then you can get where you need to be for that. Peaks, you just apply a limiter at the very top. So it is possible to pass a spec and come right through Netflix with a very, very dynamic mix, basically a feature film mix where you just adjust the level. Can stream on Netflix, and we have some of those. That's why we're asking, we're not telling. We're saying people prefer moderate dynamic range. They don't like to have to sit there and ride the levels. And so we're not enforcing that. I don't think it's really workable to force people to do that, but it will make you look better for Netflix and your clients, and will help raise the bar everywhere in the world to have things that are pleasant to listen to. I like to joke that if you don't mix it, your fans at home are going to mix it for you with the remote.
It's true. Yeah.
There's one for you here, Scott, since you've been talking about. What is the best time in the post-production post-life cycle to start prepping for M&E? When is it for an ideal M&E?
I this may not be the most Netflix happy answer, but I don't even think about the M&E until I'm done with the mix. Making that great mix is going to be the basis of a lot of the M&E work. So I have not seen success where people try to lay them both down at the same time. It can be done, and I know some of our colleagues in Latin America do that, and I've seen folks in the US do that as well. But in general, the last day of the mix, you're scheduling the M&E, and it's got to be the next day. So you know, probably the day after my mix, I'm not at Warner Brothers anymore. I'm at home. I'm flipping that dialogue track. I'm doing all those edits, picking out the Foley that I'm going to need, bringing in effects from library. And then the following day, I'm back on a stage mixing the M&E, sometimes mixing in a home studio if you have a lot of faith in that. Fortunately, the levels were already established in the final mix that you did in a great environment. So there's a little less sensitivity as to where the mix is done. We want to be on a stage whenever we can. But M&E is the first thing that happens after the mix.
Please talk about the studio dimensions a little more in detail. Again, it's recommended practices. I think as long as it translates well, it should be good. The onus is on you to make sure that it translates well, because if it doesn't, then it's going to be a problem later. This is done. I've got a little bit of, I'm a little lost here. Can we address music archival a bit? I'm not really sure what you mean by that question.
We generally want the stereo songs and cues in the score, so 1M2, 2M3, etc. And we want them labeled with the name of the cue or the song. And that's because our marketing colleagues and legal and licensing people will go into the archive and need to send these tracks out to various people for different reasons. So we just need stereo mixes of all the songs and all the score cues that are labeled right. That's the most important thing. And then we ask for the final mix project files, which includes the music fully mixed. And that is the best archival deliverable because it contains everything that happened on the stage. You know, I'm on the stage, it's day four of the mix, and the music editor's flying in fixes, and they're all being captured in that session because they're going into the final mix. So that's what we want. when there are custom songs and custom score that's done on a scoring stage, which occasionally happens, we want those multi-tracks, but I think that's less important than the final mix session and the stereo songs for our folks in music legal.
Do you have any stats on how many of your viewers watch content with closed captioning on, and what percentage of people consume content in surround sound, immersive sound? Am I allowed to give that out? No, some of it is out there and open. But I was just wondering why you would ask that question and to what effect are you wanting to know about it?
Well, a significant majority of members are watching stereo, and that's why that stereo mix has to be so great. And we're working on improvements to it all the time. About a third of members are watching in 5.1 or Atmos in some fashion. And often those are actually mixed down in the television. So a lot of TVs request 5.1 only from Netflix, and we give them the 5.1, and then they're mixing it down and you're hearing it out of the speakers. They're doing an ITU mix down. So the centers drop 3, the surrounds are drop 3, and the sub is muted. We don't have control over all the devices and how they work, but we find that the ITU mix down will generally work well if the 5.1 mix is good. So I would say people actually in home theaters or with soundbars, it's probably around like 5-ish%, but that's why we're taking these 5.1 and Atmos mixes and working on really great ways to improve stereo. And you know, we'll see what develops there.
I think Netflix India should set strict guidelines for a makers of original Netflix from India too. In terms of production sound, post-production timeline, and of course a budget for me to best sound output. We do have guidelines for that, and that is one of the things which I'm trying to accomplish. Is where the right people get paid, they get the time to do it, the budget to do what they need to do. But it all boils down to also allowing them the creative freedom which they need to do to visualize it and get it the way they want to. So it's a fine balance, but we're getting there with that. Please share all the video links which you have had attended so far. I'm sorry, I'm not quite sure I understand that.
We got a question about mixing 5.1 down to stereo, and we have published specifications that are publicly available for suggestions around how to do that. The most important thing is the center channel has to be dropped 3 dB. That's really, really important. And that's also a very standard way to do a down mix. Surrounds and LFE levels are more up to the mixer, but I think generally in my career, anywhere between -3 and -6 has worked. And the LFE generally gets injected between -8 and -12. And that's all written on the specs, which are at the Partner Help Center. I think it's partnerhelp.netflixstudios.com, but we can send that out along with other links after this.
Scott, it says here that you were going to answer about softer ambience levels taking a beating when one hears it on a smaller system. How does one tackle that?
Yeah, I think we got that one. The mobile devices often take care of themselves. We're learning that Apple does all kinds of loudness management in the device that is kind of under the hood and hidden from us. And that is why whenever people complain that the dialogue can't be heard in a title, I check it on my iPhone. And it usually is fine. And it's because they're not sending the full dynamic range broadcast mix to the phone. We're sending it, and then the phone is actually controlling that and making it work better for people on the mobile device. And Android does a lot of the same loudness management stuff on Samsung and other devices.
Is production sound mandatory for Netflix? Yes, it is. Most definitely production sound is mandatory. I think there's nothing like getting good production sound, and that's going to be one of the webinars which I intend to host next, is on production sound and just gain staging and using that, which will not be for a lot of you guys, but there are a lot of other sound people who are going to, I think, benefit from that one. It just sounds better. It sounds more real. And yes, it is mandatory.
I think another thing to add to that, Nicole, is that it just makes for, and we've seen it many times, it just makes for that better performance and better edit of the entire, title. Because you get the great production sound, you don't have to find the actors wherever they are to put them in a studio and have them recreate their lines. And it makes for a better edit, and it makes for a better mix experience also for the mixer, if they have a good performance to use there and have that translate the way that the directors wanted it to.
When we do a full, when Netflix does a full musical, we may not have the production sound always playing audibly to people, but it's great as a reference in any case, and really helpful for the moments in between songs. And in some cases you use it in the song as well. But it's just about having that reference. I like to say that nothing should be MOS where just the camera's rolling and there's no sound, because someone somewhere in the filmmaking process, it will benefit from hearing what it sounded like right there on the day.
How to optimize the workflow while working on a sound effect session when there are multiple edit changes being made frequently? Welcome to our world. It happens to all of us. I mean, that's why I've got white hair. It started very early in my career. But edit changes are going to be a given. If you manage your sessions where you've got a clean and tidy session, I think that's the beginning of it. There are various tools to help you do it. I mean, I've used Titan, and there are a lot of things from New Zealand which are out there. And it's skipping me at the moment.
Matchbox is one of them from the Cargo Cult.
So there are ways to make that easier for you. It's not really that big a deal. I mean, I've done films like Rang De Basanti, which on the last morning of mix, they came in and changed the last reel on me. And there were 9 changes where I had to cut dialogue, spot effects, and try and lift Foley to match it, because there were new scenes and it was 3 in the morning. Rock and roll is part of it, man. You've just got to try and stay on top of it as much as you can. Past a point, there's not much you can do. With OTT, you will have more time, because it's you know the dates way in advance. And we also try and make sure that you get a lock cut earlier than you would in a feature film situation. Do you guys anything to add to that?
There should, for Netflix titles, there should be less of that, because we're not testing with audiences and doing some of those things that happen in a big feature film. But there are will always be changes. I noticed whether I was working for Netflix or Amazon or Warner Brothers or Technicolor or NBC, that the broadcasts tended to be less changes than films. And even things that were going to air on linear broadcast were also more reasonable. in general. The pilots are not, you know, but we don't have pilots at Netflix, and we're not testing with audiences per se. So I think it should be more reasonable for Netflix work. But it, you know, you can't generalize. There's going to be exceptions to that.
I've just been told that Tapas has a great question.
Yeah, I see it right here. It's what are things that you advise to do for content that's releasing both in theaters and OTT platforms? Should we finish the theatrical mix first and come down to OTT, or the other way around?
I think those are two, again, those are two completely different things. It's up to you. I would say like the primary thing would be, what is it releasing on first? If it's a Netflix project, I would say that we'd like it for OTT first. I don't think in India we do releases for both at the same time. It would be either OTT or theatrical. I will bow down to Scott and Ozzy's experience, which is a little bit more than mine, having been at Netflix for longer. Any suggestions, guys?
Scott?
Well,
well, I mean, we've run into this in different scenarios with different titles from around the world, that, you know, here we may not do a theatrical release, but in other parts of the world they might, and they have done the theatrical version first, but then they also have to get back in and they do a pass to do an OTT version, you know, right away. So the director and them, they might have mixed it for theatrical and then done a pass to get it to meet OTT specs, or vice versa too. You know, there might have been that the main concern is for being on Netflix, and then there's going to just be a limited window theatrical thing that might happen for a title or a few episodes from a title. So what do you say to this, Scott? What do you think?
Yeah, I agree with all that. I speak up for what your client and the project needs, and hopefully your colleagues will listen. There's a conversation going about mixing first near field and then adapting to theatrical for a few screenings that might happen. But that isn't necessarily the right way to do it every time. So there's also a conversation about why rent a huge mix stage to do a theatrical version that will not be seen by many people, and then only do the near field version that millions will see in a couple days. So it's something for the budgeting phase, and it's something for an open conversation with the showrunner or director, and people at Netflix as well can be brought in to help with that. Ultimately, we want to do right by the showrunners and directors and all of you, and make sure you have what you need to do the very best work.
Sorry, Ozzy, did you answer the possibility of having a template of the original mix?
I was going to just say we could answer that live, because I saw that from Arif. That's a really good question. What's the possibility of having a template of the original mix shared with dub language mix studios across the world? Those that have plugin compatibility can opt to use a template of the original mix. This would make language versions far more consistent. I just wanted to say that conversation is being had quite a bit, even with our dubbing innovations team, and Scott and I have had that conversation before with them, and it's something they're looking at to see if there's a possibility of having some type of template, or at least get that information across for dub studios to know specific effects that happened on a voice at a certain point in a title, and it's definitely a conversation that's being had, and hopefully we can see that change in the future and make it more of a combined effort for all of you across the world to communicate and talk to each other and share your knowledge and templates and things like that.
Great. Sorry, I thought we were out of time half an hour earlier than Anne, but that's just me. I've been up since really early talking to these gentlemen. Last question. I just want to say before I pass this question on to Scott that we will be answering all your questions which we have on email, which we haven't had the opportunity to answer or address. And I'd just like to thank you all for being here. And I hope this has been useful. Scott, how is DME being used when we supply a fully filled M&E?
Well, the DME, so 5-1 dialogue, 5-1 music, 5-1 effects, and stereo DME are used by marketing departments always to make trailers and promotional materials so that we can drive people to watch what your work and do the promotional aspect of it. In some cases on documentary content, that can be used for the alternate language versions. We have what's called UN style dubbing, where you play the entire mix and you dub the dialogue over it, and it's a description in some cases. And but it, by and large, the DME is used for marketing and promotional, and the M&E is really crucial to be used for the dub. But fortunately, a DME is very easy to make because it's just the mix split out into the three elements.
Sorry, I'm just typing a last answer.
So, yeah, thank you, Nicole, for hosting.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. Once again, please feel free to reach out to me anytime. I'm here for you guys. And let's just really make this better.